And we're back. And yes, indeed, we are the champions, KBLP. Okay, now we're going to move on. I'm going to talk about Edgar Allan Poe. And who doesn't know Edgar Allan Poe? I'd be surprised if some people did not. However, and it's a little lengthy, I'm going to go into, but I have to go into some of it so you know where he started at. And the similarities between Poe and Lovecraft are really something. They have a lot of similarities going on. Financial difficulties, family issues. So you're going to see some. Thank you, Valerie, for wanting to be a part of it. So thank you. Thank you. Who's that? Who's that what? Hi, Chris. Yes. Welcome, 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 welcome. So we're going to see a lot of similarities between Poe and Lovecraft. But some of it's a little dry, but we need to go into some of it so you understand when he started writing and everything. So, of course, Edgar Allan Poe's work is The Raven, Complete Poems of Edgar Allan Poe, The Telltale Heart, of course, Pit and the Pendulum, The Black Cat, all those wonderful Vincent Price movies. Yes. So they couldn't have got a better person to do that. He was born in 1809 and died, unfortunately, in 1849. He's an American writer, editor, literary critic, and he's best known for his poems and short stories, particularly his tales of mystery and the macabre. He's widely regarded as a central figure of romanticism in the U.S. and American literature as a whole. I suppose because of the poems of romanticism, but I would have never thought that myself. So, and he's one of the country's earliest practitioners of the short story. He is generally considered the inventor of the detective fiction genre and is further credited with contributing to the emerging genre of science fiction. He was the first well-known American writer to try to earn a living through writing alone. And that resulted in financial difficulty, a difficult life and career for him. And it's kind of sad because I think him and Lovecraft both, they were well ahead of their time. They were geniuses. Unfortunately, America was too stuck up to notice at the time. It was that era of the bankers and the wealthy and everything. So that was not looked upon as a career, so to speak. Okay, he was born Edgar Poe in Boston. He was the second child of actress Elizabeth Arnold Hopkins Poe and actor David Poe Jr. He had an elder brother, William Henry, and a younger sister, Rosalie. Edgar may have been named after a character in William Shakespeare's King Lear because his parents were performing in his play, King Lear. And his father, unfortunately, abandoned them in 1810, a year after he was a year old. And his mother died a year later from consumption, which is pulmonary tuberculosis. So, the kid was 2 years old, he lost his father and his mother. So he was taken into the home of John Allen, who was a successful Scottish merchant in Richmond, Virginia. And he dealt in a variety of goods, including tobacco, cloth, wheat. Oh, this is good. Tombstones. And, of course, slaves. He really had his hand in everything, didn't he? The Allens served as a foster family who gave him the name Edgar Allan Poe. John Allen, he alternately spoiled and aggressively disciplined his foster son. Yeah, definitely. I know that, Chris. They are. They're an influence on a lot of people and things. So, and you enlightened me to some of that. So, but there was no in-between for John Allen. He either spoiled him or he aggressively disciplined him. There was no in-between with him. The family sailed to Boston in 1815. And Poe attended several schools on and off, and he moved back with the Allens in Richmond, Virginia in 1820. In 1824, Poe served as a lieutenant of the Richmond Youth Honor Guard. In 1825, John Allen's uncle and business benefactor, William Galt, who was said to be one of the wealthiest men in Richmond, died. He left Allen with several acres of real estate, and his inheritance was estimated at $750,000. You know how much money that was back then? That was incredible. That was just astounding. And later that summer, of course, Allen celebrated his expansive wealth and bought another home. And Poe may have become engaged to a woman, Sarah Elmira Royster, before he registered at the one-year-old University of Virginia in 1826 to study ancient and modern languages. This is rather interesting because this school was kind of like chaotic. The university was in its very infancy, of course, and was established in the ideals of its founder. And do you know who that was? Mr. Thomas Jefferson founded this school. So it supposedly had strict rules against gambling, horses. Why would you have a thing against horses? That's how they got around, right? But they had strict rules against gambling, horses, tobacco, and alcohol. But all these rules were generally ignored, of course. So I don't even know why they had them. But that was supposed to be the rules. And Jefferson had enacted a system of student self-government. Not always a good thing. Students chose their own studies, made their own arrangements for boarding, and they were to report all wrongdoing to the faculty. And we all know how that works out, right? And of course, the system was in chaos. There was a high dropout rate. But during his time there, Poe lost touch with Royster and became estranged from his father, his foster father, over gambling debts. So apparently Poe was a gambler. Okay. Poe claimed Allen wasn't sending sufficient funds for his boarding and his books and so forth. But Allen was sending money, but Poe's debts just increased. He gave up after a year, not feeling welcome in Richmond. He traveled to Boston in 1827 and sustained himself with odd jobs as a clerk and newspaper writer. And at some point, he started using the pseudonym Henri Le Renet. Okay. And unable to support himself, he enlisted in the U.S. Army using the name Edgar A. Perry and lied about his age. And that same year, he released his first book, a 40-page poetry titled Tamerlane and Other Poems. Only 50 copies were printed and received virtually no attention whatsoever. He had a very checkered military career. He was good at it, but he just didn't apply himself, basically, to it. And eventually sought to end his 5-year enlistment by revealing his real name and age. Okay? But his superior said he would only be discharged if he reconciled with John Allen. Of course, Allen was very unsympathetic, and pleas to Allen were totally ignored. Francis Allen died in 1829, and Poe visited a day after the funeral. And perhaps softened by his wife's death, he agreed to help Poe get discharged so he could receive an appointment with the U.S. Military Academy at West Point. But before entering West Point, he published his second book, LRF and Minor Poems, and that was in Baltimore in 1829. And I'm butchering these names, I know I am, so I am sorry. Poe entered West Point, and again, he went out of his way to purposely get court-martialed. John Allen had remarried, and there were bitter quarrels over the children born from Allen's affairs. Oh, not good. And the foster family disowned Poe. That was something you did not bring up. especially back then. That was men's business, so to speak. And whatever it was, it was. That was it. So Poe left for New York in 1831 and released a third volume of poems. And the book was financed by his fellow cadets. They donated 75 cents each, whatever, and they raised $170. It was printed by Elam Books of New York and labeled as a second edition, including a page saying, and I quote, "To the U.S. Corps of Cadets, this volume is respectfully dedicated." It was again reprinted. Tamerlane was reprinting Al Araf, but also six previously unpublished poems, including versions of Israfel and City in the Sea. His elder brother Henry had been ill, partly due to problems with alcoholism, and he died in August 1831. And that's when Poe began earnestly to start his career as a writer. So he had all this going on, and it was pretty difficult for him. How many, back then, of course, you know, like his foster father, he, you know, dealt in goods and slaves and all this. And, you know, Poe's trying to start a career as a writer, which alone yet. So it was really difficult. And he just, I don't know. Him and Lovecraft, they seem to have the worst luck with this. Like I said, his military career was checkered. He was good at what he did. But he chose a difficult time in American history to do so. He was the first well-known American to try to live by writing alone. And he was hampered by the lack of an international copyright law. Publishers often produced unauthorized copies of British works rather than paying for the new work. The industry was also particularly hurt by the Panic of 1837. There was a booming growth in American periodicals around this time period, fueled in part, of course, by new technology, but many did not last beyond a few issues. Publishers often refused to pay their writers or paid them much later than they promised. And throughout his attempts to live as a writer, Poe repeatedly had to resort to humiliating pleas for money and other assistance. And as a side note, in 1835, Poe, then 26, he obtained a license to marry his 13-year-old cousin, which we will get to. excuse me. So apparently, some of that, you know, still went on later on, as we know. Anyway, after his early attempts at poetry, Poe turned his attention to prose. He placed a few stories with a Philadelphia publication, and the Baltimore Saturday Visitor awarded Poe a prize in October for a short story, Message Found in a Bottle. The story brought him to the attention of John P. Kennedy, Baltimore man of considerable means. He helped Poe place some of his stories and introduced them to Thomas White of the Southern Literary Messenger in Richmond. Poe became assistant editor of the periodical in August of 1835, but was discharged within a few weeks for having been caught drunk